Hello friends, a warm welcome to yet another interesting session on instrumentation and control in power plant industries. Our today's topic of discussion is thermal mass flow meter. We know that mass is volume into density. That means our volumetric flow rate, which we measure in meter cube per hour, when multiplied by the density of the fluid, which we measure in kg per meter cube, then we will get the mass flow rate, that is kg per hour or kg per second, or even TPH, that is ton per hour. Friends, there are two types of mass flow meters. One is Coriolis mass flow meter, which we have already discussed in details in our previous session. And the second is thermal mass flow meter. So in this session, we are focusing on thermal mass flow meter, which are based on the thermal dispersion principle known as the King's law. The King's law is given by Canadian physicist L.V. King in 1914. This takes into account for different contribution of the heat transfer by convection and conduction with flow. It says that the rate of heat absorbed by flowing fluid in a pipe is directly proportional to its mass flow rate. In a typical thermal mass flow meter, gas flowing over a source of heat absorbs the heat and cools the source. Let's look at this picture. In this picture, we can see a pipeline and a thermal mass flow meter installed in it. So our thermal mass flow meters are insertion type flow meters. That is, the measuring sensor is inserted in the pipeline. Generally, we insert it to the half of the pipe diameter. Our thermal mass flow meters basically consist of two sensors. Both are RTD, that is PT100 type sensors. One of these sensors is measuring the actual fluid gas temperature. This measured temperature acts as a reference temperature. And the second sensor, in addition to measuring the fluid temperature, is also heated continuously by electrical energy. This second sensor, which is connected to heat source, is heated such that the temperature difference between these two sensors is maintained to a fixed temperature difference. Clear? Means two sensors, both are RTDs, PT100 type RTDs. One is just to measure the fluid temperature. This blue one we can see in this picture. And this red one is, in addition to measuring fluid temperature, it is also heated. And it is heated such that the temperature difference is maintained between these two sensors, and it is generally maintained to either 15 degrees or 10 degrees. Means this second red one temperature is maintained at 15 degree higher than this blue one by heating it, and the heating source is electrical energy. I hope this is clear. Then if there is no flow, the differential temperature between the two temperature sensors does not change. Means this delta T remains constant if there is no flow. But as soon as the fluid begins to flow in the pipeline, the flowing fluid draws the heat from the heated sensor. The corresponding cooling effect is immediately measured. And to maintain the same temperature difference of 15 degree, the second sensor is heated more by providing more electrical current. This heating current required to maintain the temperature difference is proportional to the cooling effect. Also, we already know by King's law that this cooling effect is proportional to the fluid flow rate. Thus, we can say this heating current is also proportional to the fluid flow rate. The greater is the fluid flow velocity, the greater will be the heat drawn, and this greater will be the heating current required to maintain the same temperature difference. Clear? Friends, I hope this funda is clear. We just want to maintain that second sensor temperature 15 degree above the fluid temperature. And as per King's law of thermal dispersion, the flowing fluid carries the heat and cools this sensor. To maintain the same temperature, we heat the sensor. And this heating current is directly proportional to fluid flow rate. This way, this flow meter directly gives the flow measurement in terms of mass flow measurement instead of volumetric measurement. This thermal mass flow meter is independent of density, pressure and viscosity of the fluid. Coming to its advantages and disadvantages, it has various advantages, like first of all, it measures directly in terms of mass flow rate. Second, it is suitable for applications where temperature and pressure fluctuates. Third is it is highly accurate and repeatable, and we can say it has an accuracy of plus minus 1% of full scale. It can measure accurately low gas flow rates or low gas velocities. Its turndown ratio is very good. It's 50:1. And last but not the least, it has no moving parts, no wear and tear, so less maintenance. But it has certain disadvantages too. First is it can be used only for clean and non-abrasive fluids. Second is thermal properties must be known. Variation from calibrated values can cause inaccuracies. Suppose the flowing fluid is basically air. And in that case, the heat absorbed by air is different. If we employ, instead the application is using hydrogen, then the heat employed will be different. And if the gas is nitrogen, then this heat absorbed will be different. Getting my point means, depending on the gas which is flowing or the gas mixture which is flowing through the pipeline, the heat absorbed would be different. So that thermal property must be known, and according to that this instrument is calibrated. If we change this application, then calibration has to be done again. Clear? And one more thing, it has a relatively high initial cost. Coming to its applications, these are suitable for a variety of applications where direct mass flow rate is required and are frequently used for regulation of low gas flows. Some of the common application areas are compressed air flows and distribution, natural gas consumption, example for burner and boiler feed control, and to monitor and control the flue gas in stacks, we can use these thermal mass flow meters. In case of gas flow mixing and blending, these are used for gas leak and testing and detection. It is used landfill gas recovery, and flare gas measurements are some of its application areas. Coming to its installation guidelines, basically it can be installed vertically, horizontally or at any angle. And regarding the minimum stage length requirement, generally it is said 10D and 5D, that is 10 times the diameter of the pipe upstream stage length requirement, and 5 times the diameter of the pipe downstream of the instrument it is required. But suppose if we have a wall, reducer, expander, bend, in that case we have to see the turbulence effect, and then we may have to increase the stage length requirement to even 20D. Clear? Means we have to see what kind of obstruction is there. Then according to that, we have to increase the stage length requirement to make this flow turbulence free. Next is, as I already mentioned, this is insertion type. So this sensor, which has basically two sensors are there. One is reference and for second is heated. So these sensors must be at the center of the pipe dia. The flow sensors probe must be installed in the center of the pipe. Next is when measuring a gas using a thermal mass flow meter, it is important that manufacturer understand the process condition of the end user's application for the meter. I told you, if the gas is air or hydrogen or nitrogen, then the cooling effect will be different. So the manufacturer must be aware of the process conditions. This way the manufacturer can calibrate the instrument matching the circumstances of the application's site. Without doing so, this flow rate inaccuracies can result. Moreover, in case of wet gas, the moisture or particle hitting the sensor can cause faster heat transfer rate. This results in spikes in measurement reading. So in order to avoid this spikes or moisture, what we do is we install this sensor at 45 degree in the pipe, so that if condensate develops in the pipe wall, gravity moves the moisture away from the sensor. Also, we can use knockout drum pots to separate moisture drops from the gas. So friends, this was all about thermal mass flow meters. I hope I'm able to clear the concept well. Your valuable feedbacks are most welcomed, so please share your feedbacks in the comment section.